plankton are probably more important than most people think. So being able to sample them at night, they're more resident plankton probably to the island.
So we move it from the container so you can just see it right there.
There's a baby mantis shrimp.
I'm Professor Anthony Richardson. I'm from the University of Queensland and CSIRO. My part of the project is focusing on the plankton, the phytoplankton and the zooplankton. And we're really interested in whether the nutrients from the guano, from the birds, which leaches into the groundwater, if we can see that in the plankton on the island. Plankton are probably more important than most people think. So plankton just means things that drift. Most of them are microscopic, and you need a microscope to see them, the phytoplankton, the zooplankton, but some are very big, like jellyfish. So the plankton are just plants and animals that drift around in the ocean, can't swim against currents. So phytoplankton, for instance, make half the oxygen that we breathe. So every second breath we take is from phytoplankton. They're the base of the marine food web, which means that they photosynthesize like plants on land, and then zooplankton eat the phytoplankton, then fish eat the zooplankton. And so particularly in open water areas, sort of deeper areas in the ocean, all the primary production is made by phytoplankton. But even in coastal areas and reef areas, a sizable proportion, maybe 50% or more, is still from phytoplankton, which are floating in the water column. One of the challenges has been, you know, the transitory nature of plankton, but by being able to sample them at night, they're more resident plankton probably to the island, so they're likely to have a stronger signature from the guano.
So basically, this is a night trap. The night trap, it's a little device that conducts some of the animals that lives in the first kind of centimeter of the sediment. Some of those kind of are directed to the light. So I'm going to basically activate the light here. So, and then I will insert this here and look it in. So you guys will see there's actually a light. So what you guys will see is those little windows. So the plankton and organisms will go through those windows and they will kind of direct it in this chamber. This mesh is really fine. This is around a fifth of a millimeter, the pores that you find over there. And you will see it later on. And then we will leave it there for 30 minutes or 1 hour of the time. And in the moment that I collect all that water, the water will be directed to this collector. So hopefully we will get a good chance of seeing some organisms that just appears during the nighttime. There are certain crustaceans that, as I said, they tend to live during the day in that space in between the grains of sand. And as you can see, we are going to deploy this not really far away. So probably will be 1 meter or 50 centimeters from the surface. So we have these floaters that will help the net to hold there. Now I'm just going to find a good spot here in Lady Elliot, and we'll see what we get later.
So the hypothesis we're trying to test really is that the conventional wisdom is most of the, I suppose, is most of the energy and nutrients from an island probably come from oceanographic sources. So from the water, you know, in upwelling and nutrients from there. And that stimulates the phytoplankton, the zooplankton, and supports reefs and open water communities. But how much of the nutrients and the energy that's coming into the food web around Lady Elliot Island is because of the seabirds and the guano that they're releasing on the island, and how much of that is leaching out in the groundwater and then getting into the marine food web around the island. We've been researching Lady Elliot Island for more than a decade to find out why manta rays come here. And one of the reasons is that the waters are pretty productive. And so there are large amounts of zooplankton at times in the water here, and manta rays are planktivorous. You know, they're very big, but they don't feed on fish, they feed on small things, zooplankton mainly. And Leaf to Reef is taking that one step further in asking the question about, you know, what's feeding the food web around Lady Elliot Island? Is it all from further offshore sources of sort of remote priming of nutrients into the area, which is feeding the productivity here, or how much of it is from the island?
So we move it from the container, so you can just see it right like now. There is something's moving. These animals are a little bit stressed, so we are going to put it there just to see the movement. And then what we'll do is put it in a container with seawater, but we will cool them down with water with ice. It's like kind of relax them because the water will change temperature. They cool down, they reduce the metabolism.
There's a
baby mantis ring.
So what we can see in that sample is all these crustaceans that we call chumaceans that actually we just find it at night time. And it already looks like a little crab just going around. They have their pincers. They kind of crawl. And the good thing about the live samples is we can see the lights and the behavior of the plankton in the way that usually they do things in the water column.
For someone who works on plankton, and someone who's a mathematical biologist and builds models, it's fantastic to come to a place like Lady Elliot Island. When you model something, you need to see what it looks like in the real world, and what a great place to come to.